the mysterious cases of the two Venus moons, Neith and Zoozve. If you read the title of this video, you're surely wondering, does Venus have a moon? Well, according to this illustration, yes, and in fact, it has a name, Zoozve. In addition, in ancient times, many astronomers, including the famous Giovanni Cassini, corroborated the existence of a moon around Venus, which they called Neith. However, to this day, there is no known moon around Venus. Or is there? What happened to these two moons? Were there ever moons around the planet Venus that disappeared over time? This video will discuss the two moons that once existed around Venus and what happened to them. Let's get started. Zoozve. Let's start with the first of the two, Zoozve. What exactly is Zoozve? The story of this curious object begins on January 26, 2024. On this day, the Radiolab Podcast aired an episode in which co-host Latif Nasser first noticed on his sun's solar system poster a natural satellite around Venus named Zoozve. Imagine the surprise that became. After all, as far as we know, Venus has no natural satellite. Or does it? Intrigued by discovering his son's poster, Nasser sent out to find who had made the illustration. Days passed, and when he could not find the author of the illustration, he began his investigation and immediately understood what was happening. To understand what happened, we must first delve into the concept of quasi-moon or quasi-satellites. Quasi-satellites, moons, or asteroids. The existence of quasi-satellites, also known as quasi-moons, was initially proposed in the context of theoretical studies on orbital dynamics in complex gravitational systems. The term refers to objects that share a planet-like orbit around the Sun, and that appear to be orbiting the planet due to their relative motion. In other words, they are objects that orbit the Sun but appear to orbit a planet. How is this? Imagine you have an asteroid with a 365-day orbit around the Sun, and right between Earth and Mars. If this planet were to move in an orbit very close to the Earth, it would appear to be traveling with the Earth around the Sun. It would appear that the Sun is gravitationally anchored to the Earth, but in reality it is anchored to the Sun. Its relative apparent motion around the Earth would be a mere optical illusion. It's a quasi-satellite that looks like a satellite, but isn't. This motion is in stark contrast to that of a moon or an actual natural satellite, which orbits a planet. In other words, what makes a natural satellite is that it is gravitationally anchored to a planet and not to the Sun. The concept of quasi-satellites was formalized in the second half of the 20th century by dynamicists such as Michael Hennen and Victor Zabili, who investigated orbital configurations arising from mutual gravitational interactions based on principles of celestial mechanics and theories previously developed by mathematicians such as Joseph-Louis Lagrange and Henri Poincaré. Based on the work of these researchers, Hennen and Zabili proposed that, in addition to the Lagrange points and the known co-orbital points, such as the Trojan orbits, there could be other stable or semi-stable configurations. Quasi-satellites were possible because they could stay close to a planet while maintaining an independent trajectory around the Sun. The theory was driven by the need to explain astronomical observations that did not fit into existing models. Arguments related to complex gravitational interactions between the Sun, a planet, and a third minor body led to the quasi-satellite hypothesis. However, this hypothesis could not be proven for over a century, and the first quasi-satellite was discovered in 2002. Orbital resonances, the definitive explanation? A quasi-satellite shares orbital resonance with a planet, meaning that both objects complete their orbits around the Sun at similar times. However, unlike natural satellites, they are not gravitationally bound to the planet. Main forces that affect its trajectory are the Sun's gravitational attraction, the planet's gravitational interaction, and orbital resonance effects. The latter is perhaps the most essential part of understanding these objects. Orbital resonance occurs when two or more celestial bodies have orbital periods in a ratio of simple integers. This generates regular and predictable gravitational interactions that can stabilize or destabilize orbits. Some prominent examples of orbital resonances in the solar system are Jupiter and Saturn. These gas giants are in a 5-2 resonance known as the Laplace resonance. Jupiter's Galilean moons, the moons Io, Europa, and Ganymede, are in an orbital resonance of 1-2-4. Pluto and Neptune. Pluto is in a 3-2 resonance with Neptune, which avoids collisions despite their crossed orbits. In the case of quasi-satellites, the orbital resonance allows the object to share the same orbital period as the planet. At the same time, its heliocentric trajectory appears synchronized with the planet's motion. Not to mention, quasi-satellites are not found within a planet's Hill sphere. The Hill sphere is a region in space around a celestial body, whose gravity dominates over a more massive object such as a star or planet. Natural satellites such as Earth's moon are within the Hill sphere of the planet they orbit, while quasi-satellites are not. Earth is the most studied planet in terms of quasi-satellites, thanks to improvements in the detection of objects close to Earth. The first identified was 164207, 2004 GU9, which was discovered in 2004. This object shares an orbit similar to Earth's and follows a trajectory that makes it look like a natural satellite, although it is not. Other quasi-satellites of the Earth are Kamo-Oalawa, 2016 HO3, 2004 GU9, 2006 VF35. However, Earth is not the only planet with quasi-satellites. The first quasi-satellite discovered was 524-522, temporarily called 2002 VE68. It is an asteroid that acts as a quasi-satellite of Venus. Renowned astronomer Brian A. Skiff discovered it at the Lowell Observatory on November 11, 2002. Although 524-522-2002 VE68 shares Venus's orbit, its stability as a quasi-satellite is limited due to gravitational perturbations from other planets, especially Earth. This discovery marked a milestone in studying orbital dynamics and paved the way for future research on quasi-satellites in the solar system. As of February 2013, it had been observed telescopically 457 times, with a data arc span of 2,947 days. 5 times it was the target of Doppler observations. Therefore, its orbit is very well determined and perhaps one of the best studied asteroids. Curiously, until recently, practically no one has discussed this object, but today it is the protagonist of this video. Do you remember the illustration we showed you at the beginning of this video about a supposed moon around Venus named Zoozve? Take a minute to consider how this name relates to the name of asteroid 2002 VE68. The artist Alex Foster is the original author of this illustration. As you can imagine, while creating the children's book, he accidentally misread his draft and confused the number 2 with the letter Z. Instead of reading 2002 VE68, he read Zoozve 68, which eventually became Zoozve. But what happened next was even more enjoyable. After this story was told on Latif Nasser's Radiolab podcast, it reached the ears of Brian Skiff, the original discoverer of the object. The story was so funny that he named the object Zoozve. He sent the proposal to the Working Group on Small Body Nomenclature, WGSBN, of the International Astronomical Union. And just a month later, the name was approved. This is how, without realizing it, an artist became a prophet, guessing what name a celestial body would have and writing it in a book long before the international astronomical community knew about it. Neith. The second moon we'll talk about is Neith. The history of this natural satellite begins in 1645 with the Italian astronomer Francisco Fontana, who after a night of observation claimed to have discovered a satellite around Venus. Initially, Fontana's announcement did not echo or have repercussions in the astronomical community because it was not well known in the field. However, in 1672, the renowned astronomer Giovanni Cassini believed he had also located a Venus satellite. Not sure of his observation, he let the event pass until 1686. After observing it again, he made his discovery public, estimating that the body was about one quarter the size of Venus. This announcement set off the alarms of astronomers around the world. Determined to observe the famous natural satellite, they pointed their telescopes at Venus to corroborate Cassini's claim, and they found it. From the moment Cassini made his discoveries public, in the following years, renowned astronomers such as James Short, Andreas Meyer, and Louis Lagrange observed the satellite up to 30 times. Abraham Schouten's observations on June 6, 1761, when he saw Venus transiting the solar disk, accompanied by a smaller dark spot that followed Venus in its path in front of the Sun, were fascinating. However, another astronomer who observed the phenomena contemporaneously, Samuel Dunn in Chelsea, England, also observed the transit, but claimed not to have seen the dark spot accompanying the planet. However, throughout 1764, two other observers documented 8 satellite observations, giving Abraham Schouten's observations more credibility than Samuel Dunn's. Observations of the satellite of Venus went on and on for many years. From amateur astronomers to renowned experts in the field, many claimed that Venus had a natural satellite, so much so that they baptized it with the name Neith, in honor of the Egyptian goddess of creation. But what happened next? Why does Venus not have any natural satellites today? Neith, the elusive moon. Although many astronomers were convinced that Venus had a natural satellite called Neith, many others renowned for their expertise in searching for astronomical objects failed to find any moons during their observations of Venus. One such astronomer was William Herschel, who dedicated an exhaustive search for the satellite in 1768, but never found it. In addition, many aspects of the satellite did not fit with its existence. For example, in 1761, Lagrange announced that Neith's orbital plane was perpendicular to the ecliptic, meaning it orbited around Venus's poles, which contrasted greatly with the planet's orbits. Another aspect that did not convince astronomers was the size. If Neith was about one quarter the size of Venus, why wasn't it always visible? After all, a body so large and close to the Sun should be easier to see than Mercury. Why had it only been discovered so few times over so many years? Due to all these unsolved facts, in 1766, Maximilian Heel, the director of the Vienna Observatory, conducted a thorough search for the satellite. When he did not find it, he proposed that the supposed natural satellite Neith simply did not exist, and that what astronomers had previously observed was an optical illusion. In his words, "Venus is so bright that the image of the planet was reflected in the observer's eyes and back to the telescope, creating a smaller, secondary image that looked like a natural satellite." While this theory could explain some sightings, it did not explain all, especially since some were made with different types of telescopes during the same observing days. In addition, most of the observations were made by experienced astronomers who understood the workings of their instruments and made essential discoveries. So what was going on? Did Neith exist or not? In 1887, the Belgian Academy of Sciences published an article with the definitive answer. In it, each Neith sighting was studied in detail, and it was determined that most of the satellite sightings could be explained by stars in the vicinity of Venus. Chi Orionis, M. Tauri, and 71 Orionis are just a few of those who may have been mistaken for Neith. Many were dissatisfied with this rather anticlimactic ending. Still, after being analyzed by experts, it was the definitive answer to the sightings of Neith, the satellite of Venus that never existed. As we can see throughout history and even in the modern era, the idea of Venus having its natural satellite has been considered. However, there is still an important question to ask ourselves. Perhaps you're also asking it. Did Venus ever have a natural satellite? We will be able to answer that in a future video. Now, we want to hear your opinion. What do you think of this story? Do you think there were ever natural satellites around Venus? Let us know what you think in the comments.